We thank the Lord who has brought us to the service today. And no doubt he has a lot in store for us. He's been speaking to our hearts, and he wants to speak to our hearts once again. And I want you to pay attention to God's word, because God has something for you. I want you to say this out loud: God has something for me. Say it one more time: God has something for me. Amen. For those on Zoom and YouTube and other platforms, you say that to yourself, because God indeed has something for you. We're going to go, we're going to pray together as we receive fresh word from heaven. Father, we thank you. We bless your name because you have something for us. We thank you for how you've been blessing us since we got in here. And we thank you once again for what you have in store for us. I'm asking that, Lord, you will speak to us even now. Let the word flow freely. Let the word flow fully. Lord, send us your word for the hour in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. And as you sent to us, help us not to be forgetful hearers. Help us to be doers of the word in Jesus' name. Let's plunge into the grace of God so that we can do the word of the Lord in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. Today I want to speak on something that, of course, is it's in the scriptures. It's in the scriptures. Some people, maybe they don't even know it's there. It's in the scriptures. Some people have abused it. It's in the scriptures. Some people have not paid attention to it because of the abuse that some other preachers have associated with this, what I'll be speaking to you about today. But I want you to believe, to look at the word together with me. It's always safe to say at the center of the word of God. You are never on one side of the extreme or the other side of the extreme. If you are on the sides of extreme, you are likely to get into the ditch. But when you stay at the center of the word of God, then the blessings of the word will be your portion. What I want to speak to you today is about God's financial plan for you. God has a financial plan for you. I said, God has a financial plan for you. And if you truly understand God, you will understand, because number one, no one can take care of you more than God. And God has your financial plan, a financial plan for you. He wants you to do well. He wants you to prosper. He wants you to have abundance. Maybe that surprises some of you, but we're going to see from the scriptures. You see, what you don't know can hurt you. The Bible says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. What you don't know can hurt you. And it's happened many times. Sometimes something belongs to you, but you didn't know you suffer unnecessarily. What would have happened if you knew it belonged to you? It's like somebody that the parents died. And before they died, they willed some money to this individual. And let's say they willed $5 million. But this person didn't read the will. This person didn't look at the details. The sorrow of the death, of the loss, was so much in our heart or in his heart. And the person is suffering. But if the person only read the will, if the person took time to look at what God had promised, then the person will wipe the tears and know that there is abundance for him. And I say to you, there is abundance for you. I say there is abundance for you. We're going to look at the word of God. I want you to see something in 3 John. 3 John and in verse 2 is only one chapter. 3 John verse 2. Here the word of God says, beloved. Beloved. Who is the beloved? This is a lover of God. Somebody who loves God. Somebody who has been born again. somebody who prioritizes for God. He or she could have been so many other places. But God is important to him. God is important to her. And the distractions that would have taken her away from God, he or she brought them away. And so this is for the beloved. You see, we read many promises in scriptures. And many people want to claim the promises. But it's important to know who the promises are for. If somebody writes a letter, when you pick a letter from the mailbox, it's typically addressed to the someone, isn't it? And you don't just pick a letter that does not belong to you. And so whenever you look at the Word of God, you want to see to whom this is addressed. It says, beloved, those who love the Lord, and because of their love for God, they consecrate unto God. What is it for the beloved? It says, I wish above all things. I wish above all things. I want you to think about that. I wish above all things. This means this is supreme and high on my mind. This is something I really want you to understand. You must never miss this. With all the things that you know, with all the things you have had, this is important. It says, I wish above all things. If you hear that, then you want to pay attention. If somebody tells you what I want to tell you is very important, and it says, this is indispensable, this is a priority, pay attention, give me your ears. This is life-changing. This will change and turn around your destiny. Don't you want to pay attention? You want to. What is it that the Lord wants to speak to our hearts about? I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper. You in particular. That's why it's God's financial plan for you. He says, I wish above all things that you prosper. Your prosperity glorifies God. Your prosperity can make help you to be a blessing to many. I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper, that you in particular. Say, he's talking about me. He's talking about me. That thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Did you notice something there? It covers our spirit, our soul, and our body. It says that for you, as you're doing well spiritually, the desire of God is clear that you also prosper financially. That's the plan of God. And as we pay attention to it, great will be the reward in Jesus' name. You see, many believers live in penury. Many live in lack because of ignorance. The ignorance of God's plan for their financial dominion. God wants you to have financial dominion. And if you don't know, you can suffer unnecessarily. Every child of God can enjoy financial prosperity. The scripture is abundantly clear about God's plan, God's provision, God's path, and principles for the believer's prosperity. When carefully and consistently practiced, I want you to pay attention to those. When carefully, somebody say carefully. Say it one more time. Say it one more time. You know, one of the reasons why I ask that you say it is that when you repeat, it registers to your spirit. When carefully and consistently practiced, somebody say consistently. You see, that's the way to get the best of God. You're carefully practicing what God says, and you do it consistently. Not that you do it for 1 year and you stop. Not that you do it for 2 years and you stop. Or for a number of years and you stop. That person does not get the best of God. But when carefully and consistently practiced, every child of God can affirm that God's word on finances work. If you practice it carefully, consistently, you can affirm that God's word on your prosperity, on your financial provision works, because God cannot fail. Now, as we think about this, I want to talk today, because we'll finish this next Sunday if Jesus tarries. I don't want to rush it. I want to make sure you get what God has for you. As we think about God's provision, God's financial provision, what is the provision of God for you? I want you to think about this. Suppose you go to the ocean, and the ocean is before you. And as you see the ocean before you, can you dry that ocean? No, can you dry that ocean? No, you cannot. That's just a little picture I can give you to the abundance of divine provision. The provision of God is so vast, is so great, is so abundant, that if we pay attention to it, then these will come into your life. That's what God wants to do. That's what God wants to do for you. Now, I want you to see something from God's word. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And then look at these in verse 9. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's not talking about financial provision outside of Christ. It's talking about financial provision with Christ as your Lord and Savior. And the people that this is written to are those who have made Jesus as their Lord and Savior. It says, for ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes it became what? It became what? It became what? Poor. Now, I want you to think about something. There are different levels of being rich. If a little child that just got a bank account opened and has $200 in his account or in her account, a young adult may say, I'm rich. And then you say, how much do you have in account? He says, I'm rich. Tell us, how rich are you? He says, I have $200 in the account. That may be good for that person. Is that not so? But then when God's word says, though he was rich, rich is rich. Rich is rich. Is the one that can supply missing eyes. Is the one that can supply missing limbs. Is the one that can change lives. Though he was rich, but look at what he did. Yet he became poor. Yet he became poor for our sakes, that through his poverty, that ye through his poverty, that you in particular, through his poverty, might be rich. That's the plan of God. He wants you to be financially prospered. And as we think about the financial provision that the Lord gives, I want you to pay attention to the provision. And then if Jesus tarries next Sunday, I'll talk about the principles. But as we look at the provision of God, it's so vast, it's so great. Look at this, for example, in Genesis 22. Genesis 22. Genesis 22. And I'm going to read from verse 15. And the angel of the Lord called unto Abram out of heaven the second time, and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord. For because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thy only son, he obeyed the Lord. Remember the song we sang? Trust and what? Trust and what? Obey. That's the secret of blessing. And the blessing of the Lord make it rich. Somebody say, make it rich. I can hear you well. I can hear you well. The blessing of the Lord make it rich. And he had no sorrow to it. The blessings that some other people get, it has a lot of sorrow, a lot of heartaches. But the one that is coming from above, the one that is coming from the Lord, It maketh rich, it advances you, and it hath no sorrow to it. It says, because you have obeyed my voice, because thou hast done this thing, and hast not withheld thy son, thy only son, that in blessing I will bless you. And in multiplying, I will multiply thy seed as the stars of heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast done what? Obeyed my voice. Obedience is the key. It's what gets us into the abundance that God has in store for us. Now, I want you to pay attention to the word of the Lord as we think about the abundance that the Lord has in store for us. Now, when we think about the divine abundance, I need you to understand the way God works. God works little by what? Little. You see, many people don't understand the way God works. They want to rush. They want to run. And the Bible tells us that he that maketh haste to be rich shall not be innocent. Let me show you from the word so that you don't think I'm just quoting it, you know. Let me show you in Proverbs 28. Proverbs 28. And look at this in verse 20. A faithful man shall abound with blessings. A faithful man. Faithful to the Lord. And faithful in other areas as well. If it's a husband, faithful in the role. A wife, faithful in the role. A child, faithful in the role. A believer, faithful to the Lord. And all that the Lord commands. It says, a faithful man shall abound with what? With blessings. There'll be blessings that God will make sure flows. But he that maketh haste to be rich shall be what? Shall not be what? Why don't we all read that latter part together from but he? One, two, go. I can't hear you well. He that maketh haste to be rich. The one that says God is too slow for me. I want to make it. All my friends are making it. I want to make it. 2 years. 2 years. Become a billionaire. God says, he that maketh haste to be rich shall not be what? Because the person will cut corners. This person will skip church. The person will do some dirty things that will bring divine judgment. The way God works is very different. You see, God thinks about the end from the beginning. God does not want us to get hurt in the process. He prepares us adequately so that we can manage whatever he gives us. And you see, sometimes when people try to be rich and try to be rich, sometimes they even die before their time. But as we make sure and see the principle of God, little by little, then there can be great progress in our lives in Jesus' name. I want you to see something in Exodus 23. Exodus 23. And see the word of God in verse 30. Exodus 23. What verse? 30. Look at it. By little and what? By little and what? Little. I will drive them out from before thee until thou be increased and inherit the land. God says, I want you to inherit the land. But how am I going to do it? I'm going to do it little by little. Because there are some things that some people cannot manage where they are. You know, when you think about a little child, and you give a little child 2 months old, and you say, little child, I give you $100. Smile now. And the child smiles. But to that child, is that money $100 or paper? Paper. And what will the child do with that paper? It's going to just destroy it. Unless mommy says, quickly, it takes the $100 from him or that child. You see, there are things God will not give us because he does not want them to destroy us. Haven't you seen sometimes you read in the papers that a family has a gun at home? And because they had a gun at home and they didn't secure the gun well, one of the children took the gun and killed a family member. Have you heard that before? Yeah. And God does not want us to die before our time. And so he plans our lives so that little by little we can inherit the land. Again, I know we've talked about Joseph. God was preparing him to rule the whole of Egypt. And you know, Egypt was the superpower at that time. It's like when you think about our country here, our U.S. You know, Egypt was the superpower. And if Joseph was going to rule at that level, God needed to train him. How did he do it? By little and little. First in Potiphar's house, and he did a good job with administration. He managed that house well as though it was his own. And God said, now it's time to promote you. He might not know that, you know, God was promoting him when he went into prison. Do you know that there are some promotions God gives you, but you don't know his promotion? But because he knows what he wants to do for you, he knows his promotion. I said he knows his promotion. How do we know he knows his promotion? How do you know it was for his promotion? That was how he got to know who? The butler. If he was not in the prison, how would he have known the butler? And when Pharaoh had a dream and did not know the meaning of that dream, the interpretation of that dream, the butler said, I remember my fault today. And then they had to go and call Joseph. It was for his promotion. Sometimes the Lord allows some things to happen for our promotion, but they look like demotion. If you will believe the Lord and wait gently on the Lord, you will see that it will lead to your exaltation in Jesus' name. Remember, that's what the Bible says. The Bible says, and we know. Somebody say, we know. We know that all things work together for good to those who love God, who are the called according to what? His purpose. When you truly love the Lord, all things will work together for your good. I said they will work together for your good. And so he learned administration there in Potiphar's house, learned administration in the prison, and then administration in the palace. That's it. God took him higher. And if we will make sure we walk with God, then he will do the same in Jesus' name. How does God work? By little and little. By little and little. That's the way the Lord works. Little by little. And you see, there's the power of little. If you don't understand, sometimes people despise, that's why the Bible says, despise not the days of small beginnings. Some people despise small beginnings. Despise a small thing. They say, is this all? Oh, thank God for that, because that thing will be multiplied soon. You see, sometimes people are looking for a job, and God gives them a job. And remember, they were praying, oh, God, give me a job, give me a job. And they got a job. After they started working, and they were getting paid, and then they're saying, is this all? I don't even think I want to give my best here. Is this all? And yet God is watching. Do your best there, and God will open another door. So we must make sure that we understand the principles of God. We do not despise the days of small beginnings. By little and little. You see, when you think about the power of little, that's a lot. We'll talk about that in the principles. A little, you've heard this before, little drops of water do what? Make a mighty ocean. By little and little. Because God is interested in our character being developed. If you give $1 million, if you give $10 million to a person that is stingy, that money is not going to leave his house or her house. It's not going to benefit much people. In fact, the more money you have, the more it reveals what you already have. If you are stingy, you are more stingy. If you are wicked, you are more wicked. Have you heard some people that have a lot of money and they are wicked to their employees? You see, it just reveals what you already have inside. That's why it's important that there is character building in our lives. As we think about the provision of God, God certainly wants to prosper us. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, Deuteronomy chapter 28, I want you to see this, Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1. Look at what God's word says. Before I read that to you, God is the great master planner, and he has thoroughly planned for your life. I thought somebody would shout a louder amen. You know, when you know God has thoroughly planned for your life, it should make you rejoice. It should make you smile. Show that you can smile now. So that you rejoice that God has planned for your life. Notify your face. Unless maybe the mask is blocking your face from smiling. You see, when you know that God, the great master planner, has thoroughly planned for your future, it should make you to be at rest. It should make you to rejoice because your future is as beautiful, is as bright as the promises of God. God has planned for his own, and he can take care, and he wants to take care of you. And so as we trust the Lord will take great care of us in Jesus' name. This is the believer's heritage because of redemption. When we're born of God, we're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. When you say somebody is a heir, what does it mean? It means he owns everything that what this other person has. The Bible says we're heirs of God. That means everything God has belongs to me. Everything that God has belongs to me. Everything that God has belongs to me. Please speak it, let it come out in French. Everything that God has belongs to me. Praise the Lord. 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 When you understand and truly understand that everything that God has belongs to you, it changes how you live. It changes how you think. It changes what you do. It changes your life. It changes how you carry yourself. When you truly know that everything that God has belongs to you, it brings a change into your life. Praise the Lord. One more time, praise the Lord. It says we are joint heirs with God. We're heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. That should carry worry and anxiety from your heart. I said that should carry worry and anxiety from your heart. As we understand that, now Deuteronomy chapter 28 in verse 1. Deuteronomy chapter 28, verse 1. And it shall come to pass. Somebody say it shall come to pass. Say it very well. For those on the different platforms, say it also. And it shall come to pass. Hallelujah, it's going to come to pass. That you may not see the abundance now, but remember it will what? Come to pass. You may not have seen the abundance now, but it will come to pass. 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 And so as you think about that, the word of the Lord says, and it shall come to pass, that if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord your God, you pay attention to his voice, you pay attention to his word, you do not think you are smarter than God. If I were to ask you here, is anybody here that thinks he's smarter than God? Anybody on Zoom thinking he's smarter than God? No. If anybody thinks like that, that's a problem. I said that's a serious problem now. Thank God nobody raised his hand. Because there is no one smarter than the only wise God. If he's the only wise God, then you cannot be smarter than God. And so he says, if thou wouldst diligently, hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord your God will set you on high. Somebody shout on high. Somebody shout on high. Somebody shout on high. Now, I'm going to show you later next Sunday how it happens. The principles. Because you see, there is the divine provision, but there are principles. How God is going to actually accomplish that in our lives. It says it will set you on high above all nations of the earth. Somebody say above. Somebody say above. Where do you belong? Where do you belong? Where do you belong? Where do you belong? It said it will set you on high above all what? The nations of the earth. And these blessings shall come on thee. And these blessings shall come on thee and overtake you. You know what that means? When blessings overtake you, it's like blessings are running after you. What is running after you? You know, there are some people, they say, well, you know, Pastor, I slept and it appears weird things are running after them. They might call it masquerade. They might call it some strange things with somebody with mask, black, dark things on and different. And say that thing is running after them and they are sweating. What is running after you? Blessing. Praise God, that's what is running after me. I said, that's what is running after me. It says that these will overtake you. If thou shalt hearken unto the voice of the Lord your God. Can God lie? Can God lie? It does not, it cannot. And because God does not lie, we must therefore make sure we take heed to the word of God. We must make sure we align with God's financial plan. And when we align with God's financial plan, you will discover, we will all discover that is more than enough. I said, God is more than enough. I said, God is more than enough. I said, God is more than enough. God is bigger than your uncle. Your uncle that you are trusting. What happens when that uncle is no more there? What will you do? I said, God is bigger than your uncle. You can trust in him and you'll find him to be more than enough in Jesus' name. I said, you'll find him to be more than enough in Jesus' name. Now, how do we align with God's financial plan? I'll give a few things and then we will pray. Number one, you must align with God's financial plan in your thoughts. Somebody say, my thoughts. Somebody say, my thoughts. You wonder how your thoughts affect where you arrive. Let me give you this simple illustration. How many of you were thinking of going somewhere, but then what was on your mind was something else, and you discovered you find yourself where your dominant thought was instead of the place you were planning to go? How many of you, if that is the case, raise your hand. You were planning to go somewhere, but then there was something else that was high priority on your mind. And you were driving, but then you discovered that the dominant thought on your mind is where you went to. If that has happened to you, raise your hand. You see, your thought will affect where you arrive. The Bible says, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Where you arrive is determined by your thoughts. You cannot consistently, continually think thoughts of poverty and arrive at prosperity. It's very important how you think. God's word is very clear. Look at this in Proverbs 23. Proverbs 23. And then in verse 7. Proverbs 23. And then in verse 7. For as he thinketh in his heart. That means as he thinks in his heart. Did you notice that? That's why it's your dominant thoughts. You're thinking about it, you're thinking about it, you're thinking about it. Even though there was a different place you wanted to go. But your dominant thoughts determines your arriving point. The Bible says, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. That's why it's important what we think and how we think. Not only that, the other thing we must align with is, so you align with God's thoughts. You align with what? God's thoughts. God's thoughts are revealed in his words. When you read a book, the book is expressing the thoughts of the what? The author, isn't it? And when you read God's word, it's expressing his thoughts. That's why he says, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you the expected end. And so God's words are God's thoughts. And you must align with God's thoughts to arrive at God's destination. Very important. You cannot consistently think thoughts of poverty and arrive at prosperity. The scriptures cannot be broken. Very important. What else is the other thing we must align with? We must align with the words. The words we speak must align with God's word. Our words must match God's word. I don't know, maybe you have seen this before, but I want to show you a verse that you need to pay attention to. Somebody, turn to your neighbor and say, please pay attention to this. What pastor is about to say is very important. I can't hear you well. Very good. Look at this in Mark chapter 11. Mark 11, and then in verse 23. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he seeth shall come to pass. I want us to read the remaining part of that verse. One, two, go. He shall have what? Whatsoever he seeth. What you continually say will affect your destination. Will affect what you have. He shall have whatsoever he seeth. Well, this, I don't think I'm a success. Daddy told me I'm a failure. Mommy said this is a failure, and you are also saying the same thing, then you will not be able to arrive at success. But regardless of what anybody has said, if you make a change and say God's word says I'm a success and I am a success. God's word is stronger than the words of men. God's word is greater than the words of men. God's words are stronger and greater than the words of men. And so that we must align our words with the word of God. Remember what God says. I wish above all things that thou mayest what? Prosper. Even in the face of challenges, speak the word of God and you will see the fulfillment in Jesus' name. Finally, our actions must match the word of the Lord. And we must align our actions with the word of God. And I'm going to show you that, because this is important. Look at what the Lord says here in Psalm 1. Actually, when you think about, let's look at Joshua chapter 1 so that I can sum it up for you. You can read Psalm 1 from verse 1 to verse 3 yourself. It tells us, we've looked at that before, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor seated in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night, and he shall be like a river, like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall what? Prosper. Now, Joshua chapter 1. Joshua. So read Psalm 1 verse 1 yourself later. Let's look at Joshua chapter 1. I know some of you may be able to quote it as well, but let's look at these. And then we'll learn from the word of the Lord. Joshua chapter 1, and then in verse 8. Look at what the Lord told Joshua. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. What will you consider that to be? Your words, isn't it? Is that not your words? And then, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night. What do you consider that to be? Your thoughts, isn't it? That thou mayest observe to do. What is that? Your actions, isn't it? You see the summary? Your words, your thoughts, and your actions must align. It says that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then, somebody say for then, thou shalt make your way prosperous, and then thou shalt have what? good success. The Lord wants us to align our thoughts, to align our words, to align our actions with His word, and the abundance of His provision will flow into our lives. We're going to go to the Lord in prayers shortly. Next Sunday, we'll talk about some practical principles from scriptures that will get you to the destination. And God will bring it to pass in your life. It's important to know His provision, but we must know the principles. When the principles and the provision connect together, then the plan of God for your life will be accomplished in Jesus' name. Let's all rise up as we pray together. I'm sure the Lord has spoken to you, isn't it? Whatever the Lord has spoken to your heart, take it to the Lord in prayers. And commit yourself, if you're not yet born again, if you're not yet a child of God, make sure you are. Give your heart to Jesus. Be born again today. Let Christ be your Lord and Savior. Oh, nobody can love you like Jesus. No one else died for you like Jesus. Make sure you give Him the first place in your heart. Let Him be your Lord and Savior today if you have not. Oh, Christ paid the price. He shed His blood on your behalf. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon Him. And by His stripes we were healed. If you will look to the Lord today, you will make a change in your life. You will be transformed. You will be changed. And then you will become a child of the Lord. And remember, when you become a child of God, by repenting of your sins, you turn away from them, you confess them to the Lord, and you believe, faith, in the sacrifice of Christ, that He was buried, He rose again for your justification, then thou shalt be saved. It's instantaneous. The Lord can do that right now for you. I'll be praying for you as well. And for others, align your thoughts, align your words, align your actions with God's financial plan, and you will discover that you will arrive at the destination of God's financial provision. That's what God wants to do for you. I want to pray for everyone. If you have not given your heart to Christ, do that right now. I'll be praying for you. If you have given your heart to Christ, commit yourself to obeying God, to aligning your thoughts. Maybe you're the one that says, well, I don't know if I will prosper here. I don't know if I will succeed. I don't know. And your words are the things that defeat you. Or your thoughts are the things that defeat you. Or your actions are the things that defeat you. Pray that the Lord will help you. You've gotten yourself in some unnecessary debts because of your actions that you didn't think through. Pray, let the Lord help you. And the Lord will make a change in your life as you look to Him. In Jesus' name, we have prayed. Let's pray now for those on the different platforms as well as those in the sanctuary here. I want to pray for you. If you're giving your heart to Christ today, wherever you are, Jesus sees you. Just say it quietly, Lord, I'm giving my heart to you today. And then I'll pray for you. I repent of my sins. I turn away from them. Come into my heart, Lord. Make my heart your residence. I want you. I need you. Lord, come in and rule in my life. I'm going to pray for you now, and then I'll pray for everyone. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to thank you for what you have done. I thank you for your word that has come forth. As many as are making a decision to turn to Jesus as Lord and Savior today, oh God, I pray, forgive their sins in Jesus' name. Change their lives, Lord. Lord, I pray that the power of sin will be destroyed from their lives in Jesus' name. Give them the power to go and sin no more. Lord, I pray that you help them to live the Christian life as new creatures. Father, I thank you for the answer. I pray for everyone else. Lord, I pray, as you have spoken to us about the provision of heaven, help us to align with this provision in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that the abundance you have promised will flow into the lives of your people. Help us to be obedient to your word, trusting and obedient to your word. And then the abundance that you have promised will be our possession in Jesus' name. It's a new month. Make it, Lord, the month of provision. Divine provision, definite supply, and then the abundance of heaven flowing into every heart, life, and family in Jesus' name. I thank you, Father, because I know you have answered. Glory to God in the highest. And everybody said, amen. God bless you. Thank you for coming to the service today. Please, our guests, I'd like to see you. So just come and sit in front here. I'd like to see you briefly. Our workers, I'd like to see you also briefly. And please shake a few hands before you go. Give a fist bump or give a elbow bump. And say hi to a number of people before you go. And let's remember, next Sunday we'll continue the series. Invite others.